Actually, the correct quote is, you don't have to give up everything in life, not even your motorcycle.
Yes.
Buddha said that.
Yes, yes. Okay. All right.
This interview was taken as part of a ride from Delhi to Singapore in 2019 and was shot in Thimphu, the capital of Bhutan.
All right, guys, so we are here in Thimphu. What a surprise. And if you've seen movies, if you see movies, you know Kelly is also has been acting in Indian movies as well as in Telugu movies. And welcome, Kelly. Thank you so much for making our time.
Thank you, Sunil.
I really appreciate it.
Nice to meet you, and Sunil.
And the best part is that you're also a motorcyclist. And what could it be better than, you know, because motorcycling, I think, is a great leveler. And now we just want you to say about something about yourself as a motorcyclist and as well what you did in India.
I'm a Telugu actor from, yes. from Bhutan.
Yes.
I haven't done work for around 2 years now,
right.
But we'll be coming back into television perhaps.
Right.
But in the meantime, I've been enjoying my biking that I've been doing most of my life anyways.
Right.
And regarding what you said, it puts you on a level, so that's important. Because biking, you will agree with me, I'm sure, has a humbling sort of effect on everybody.
Yes.
Where the machine that you ride or the roads that you ride on all one day will get you one way or the other.
Yeah,
so it's not a question of, you know, if I fall, it's a question of when you'll fall.
Yeah, absolutely. You're talking like a motorcycle. That is the best thing. Yeah,
yeah, I've had a few close calls and a few bang ups, which, okay. You know, I can count some lives on. And deformities on my body on. So, yeah, that's what I'm left with, you know, all kinds of shoulder and yeah. knees and, you know, whatever. But it just shows that I was a crap rider to start with. But hopefully now people will agree with me that I'm more comfortable on my machine and I'm better on my bike. Even though I ride less on the roads because of traffic, you know, I do a little bit more hard enduro now. Yeah.
Uh-huh. So let me actually go back to the, you know, time when you were acting in India.
Mm.
You also acted with John.
Yes, that's
and
right. Yeah.
John is also a motorcyclist. So what do you used to talk about, like, off the camera? Of course, motorcycles probably.
Well, you know, we never really interacted much. But once in a while, he would tell me, oh, yeah, man, these guys in Rajasthan, they fixed up this bike for me. You should come and take a look at it.
Yes.
So, you know, I go over and they fixed up this beautiful motorcycle for him. It was really nicely done. But, you know, on the streets of Bombay, you can't really test or get the feel of a motorcycle. So we didn't get to take it into the outbacks, maybe into Lonavala area, you know, yeah, get into the Lavasa, yeah.
But Bhutan is the Lavasa of Southeast Asia.
Oh.
Let me put it that way.
It's a real, you know, I'm really grateful to our royal government for improving our roads, for widening it. It's become a little safer for bikers.
Oh, it's amazing.
Yes.
It's not improved. It's like a racetrack. Like,
was like be careful. We got speed traps everywhere.
Yeah, like that,
yes.
Yeah.
But like you say, it's smooth. But the nice thing is we have the options to go off-road when we want to go.
Yes.
We know exactly where we're going to go. We don't have too many loops where we go up and come down a different way. We generally go up and come back down the same way.
Yeah.
But it's still such a wonderful experience. And we have now so many feeder roads and farm roads all over. So we just make sure we're, you know, warm up on the smooth roads. And then when we're ready, we head off onto something darker.
You're talking about enduro?
No, we, I'm a Triumph boy.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
So I take my 800
okay.
and I go on some pretty rough roads. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Never dropped it once.
Wonderful.
Yeah. I feel bad if I do.
So, you know, Kelly, tell me, which is your dream motorcycle to start with?
You know, I was really, really keen on the BMW 800 Adventure. I love the fact that the fuel was under the fuel at the seat at the back, and it kind of balanced the bike out, because I felt my Tiger and the other BMWs were a bit front and top heavy.
Yes.
And on our mountain roads where we take sharp bends, it kind of flops a little bit. I don't know if you ever experienced that, you know.
The GSA, I rode the 27 liters one, with completely loaded.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a feeling. I mean, it was unnecessarily heavy.
Yeah.
That is what I felt.
You mean you had the panniers and all?
Everything. The top case, panniers, tank bag,
yeah,
everything.
Yeah, yeah. You know, when you have bikes like that,
you gotta
attack corners.
Yes.
You gotta just commit and be more aggressive.
Or have a body like John Abraham.
Yeah. That's right, yeah. And, you know, he's very passionate about his bikes. I think he has another one. Was it the R1? He has a Ninja? Does he have a Ninja?
Well, he has ZX14.
I think that's the one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he liked that a lot. He was really into that. I wasn't really into street bikes. I like adventure bikes. I like enduro bikes. I don't mind that BMW, the S1000.
RR?
RR.
Or that I have.
You have it?
Yeah.
Oh, dude.
But
how's that?
Race bike.
It's, yeah, I know, but...
Oh, that's amazing.
At one point in time, it's the fastest road bike, right?
Yeah, no, I mean, so the H2 is now.
Oh, yeah, but for a while, that one was
they
really...
Keep,
it couldn't be more than a few kilometers apart.
2.3, seconds, 0 to 100 and stuff.
But that bike, I saw it when I was in the UK last, when we went out.
People have been doing enduro stuff with their 1000 RRs, Panigales, you know, something different.
Well, you know, I like to use the right equipment for the right purpose, but I know many people, including some of my crazy but very talented cousins who are riders. I mean, they'll happily take a street bike up a mountain if it needed to be done, you know, and they do it well. But again, it's not safe. It doesn't have all that. So I don't recommend it for anybody. I always tell everybody safety first.
Yeah.
If you don't feel you can do it, then don't, you know, and just take it in baby steps and go through the process of thing. Don't be a hero and think, yeah, you're going to do it, because I have landed up in my destination before my bike many times, thinking I'd do it.
Right. So, Kelly, what's your favorite dream destination that you haven't ridden as yet?
I'd love to ride on the roads in Italy, in the countryside of Italy.
Yes.
Only because the countryside is so beautiful. Mm-hmm. I was there on road in a car, you know, and in the back of a van. It was really nice up to the point I felt, shit, man, this would be really good on a bike. Then I was like, oh, forget this van. Where's the bike? But it was time to go home by that time. So one day I'll go back and maybe get on a bike and, you know, ride up that way. But maybe then it would be a nice street bike.
Yeah, maybe the Ducati Multistrada in Europe.
Oh, nice.
Something like that.
Nice. You guys cover bikes like that, don't you, in your magazines?
Yeah, for sure. Like,
very nice.
Day and night.
Thank you so much for your copy. I look forward to going through it.
No, so guys, we have given a part of the culture of what we have in India to Kelly.
This is ex-BHP. You got to get into this, because it's not only going to tell you about what's out there in the market. It's going to tell you about riding practices, disciplines, techniques, maintenance, so much thing. You know, if you have a soul as a biker, this is the magazine to have. This is your Bible.
And we also do experiences. Like, we are going to cover this entire ride of 11 countries in the magazine and, of course, online, as you know. So, Kelly, I mean, what do you think about how is motorcycling developing in Bhutan?
In Bhutan, we have very many motorcyclists coming up now. The younger lot, as you mentioned earlier, interested more in street motorcycles, maybe like 60-40, 50-50 sort of tires. So they have the option to go onto dirt roads, but they stick mainly to the roads. We don't have big riding fraternities, but we have small groups of friends. It's all very friendly. It's all very nice. We don't permit... I come from a club called the Tariana Dragons. We don't permit our members to wear our cuts off official rides. There's no feeling of a gang idea. There's no groupism. You belong to a community. So you shouldn't stand apart until you're doing a service for that community.
Yes.
So we believe in that. And we wear our cut only when we are doing the service for that community, and in this case, this interview with you.
You know, and there's one more thing, because earlier I met a few more bikers, and they said that giving charity is a very important part of motorcycling clubs in Bhutan.
Well, it's a Buddhist principle, right?
Yes.
So, you know, when you do charity and when you benefit another sentient being, it's called gewa, you know. So you get certain amount of good karma accumulated.
Absolutely.
Towards your rebirth. That's our principle. We were not always, the cleanest club in the world, in the sense that it was a group of friends and we were doing charity, but along the way we used to drink a little bit and, you know, enjoy ourselves. But we used to call it contributing to a local economy.
Yes.
But as time went on, our responsibilities grew. And not only our responsibilities, but our eyes were opened by the service that we did.
Mm-hmm.
And every charity ride that we went on just made us a little bit more serious about the work we did. And of course, we are filled with a group of jokers in our club, but we are very serious about the work that we do. We're not allowed to drink on rides, absolutely focused on what we do. We go down, we meet with the people, we interact, we make sure that everything is done properly, we get back. And whenever, even in our social lives, if we're riding, no drinking.
And I've heard that in the charity rides, you actually sleep in places like classrooms.
Well, not just classrooms. In some extended classrooms in very remote parts of Bhutan, some classrooms are perhaps just tin sheds that are not fully walled, just halfway up, you know. So up to about 3.5-4 feet is just a wall of a tin sheet, you know. And we'd be sleeping out there on the mud, and, you know, we just get some stuff and lay it out, pat it down, make sure it's dry, comfortable. I don't want snakes, so I make sure I'm on the highest part.
And basically, it makes you, when you come back, it makes you appreciate what we have.
Of course.
That's what
I mean. It's not just where we have to sleep, but where we have to go.
Yes.
There have been several charity rides where we actually ride our motorcycles across a suspension walking bridge, which is really scary when the winds are high. And then we go up roads that are literally non-existent. So we're taking, and in this case, we are forced to, Enfields, for example, up roads which require much better tire treads and engine power, but still managing, taking goods on our back and everything. And, you know, in some cases, we have so much on our back, we're literally wheeling all our way up the hill, but it's good fun. And stopping at a certain point and then having to walk another maybe 4 hours,
wow,
4.5 hours. And then delivering the goods to the people of the community which we're targeting.
It must be very therapeutic.
You know, when you get there and you're doing it, it's very humbling because you don't feel proud. You don't feel, challenge done. This is something which you feel you might feel when you get there. But when you actually do it, you know, it's just another day. But then when you come back, you feel a little bit changed. You know,
I feel we should have these kind of rides in India. We don't do.
It's so important,
stuff,
you know.
And because, I don't think anyone does in India.
Yeah, I mean,
this sort of thing.
Yeah, biking communities. We have a reputation, you know, guys in leather, rough, you know, noisy guys. You know, give them some space, otherwise there might be something going on. But actually, it's not like that at all. You know, you just if biking communities give back to a community, or, I mean, they don't have to. This is not a hard and fast rule, but it can be a very meditational Zen experience if you do, you know, because as a community, you may ride, but what's there beyond riding? So our motto is love to ride, ride to love.
That's just a matter of one letter.
Yeah.
It changes everything.
Exactly.
Wow. And, Kelly, so we started this ride practically from Lumbini in Nepal, where Gautam Buddha, he was born.
Very probably.
So I was really glad to, you know, go over there. The thing that I've been reading in textbooks, and since Bhutan is based on the entire the Buddhist principles, I just want to ask you this one final thing. How much, like, your motorcycling is also influenced, but how much of that is actually contributing to the fact that we hear that Bhutan is the most happiest country in the world.
Mm.
You know, so how much, like, I mean, it's a very vague question I'm asking.
Well, I don't know if our contribution makes up towards the happiness of the country, but the happiness of the country definitely makes us do charitable deeds the way that we are doing. The fact that we have tools like motorcycles to do it on makes it that much more enjoyable. The fact that we're passionate about riding and to be able to be charitable makes it that much more enjoyable. You know, to have a brotherhood of friends who all share a passion for engines, no matter whatever kind it might be, and not just that, but learn from our fellow, like one guy's really into like weapons and blades and just collecting them, and he's called Blade Rider. Another guy is an international motocross champion himself, who's Chris Major out of the UK, and you know, and to learn biking techniques from him because he's had so many years of experience of crash and burning. But all that makes the experience so much more enjoyable.
Yes, and you know, I'll be very frank that before coming here, I read up on Buddhism a little bit. Mm. I'm from India, so it's not really an alien principle to me.
Yes.
But what Gautam Buddha essentially said, you can correct me if I'm wrong,
yes,
is that he said that you don't need to give up everything. Mm. But you don't need to be a completely materialistic person as well. So that there's a middle path.
Yes.
So I feel, is that motorcycling is a middle path,
yeah,
of enjoying your life and also giving back to the world. And in this case, they have this gentleman and the group of people have kind of perfected that middle path as far as motorcycling is concerned. And please tell me if I'm wrong about the principle.
Actually, the correct quote is, you don't have to give up everything in life, not even your motorcycle.
Yes.
Buddha said that.
Yes, yes. All right. So I'm going to go back now. I'm going to go to Gaya. And I'm going to seek the Bodhi tree, and perhaps I'm going to get more enlightened.
Yeah.
But thank you so much, Kelly. If you want to say anything to our people,
not at all,
watching in India, especially the young riders.
I'd like to start by wishing Sunil, Sunny, and their friends a safe 90 days, 11 countries, riding around Asia, Southeast Asia, and back into Sri Lanka, back into India. Ride safe, ride well. And to all you bikers out there, I hope you all enjoy your machines, look after your machines, maintain your machines, your equipment, and I hope we'll be able to ride together one day. I look forward to meeting you. Get your copy of XBHP and let's get on the same page.
Hearing from a man. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you, Leah.